All right, very good. How are we doing? All right, we're up and running, folks. Well, right about now, it's 3:38 Pacific Standard Time, and the Super Bowl is kicking off, I am sure. And this is your Super Bowl party here. It's an alternative to watching the Super Bowl. We're not going to watch it, you see. We're going to do something better, and I'm your coach. I've got the headset on, you know, like you see the coaches on the sideline radioing in the place to the quarterback. So I'm going to radio in the place to you, but their spiritual place. Right now, Greece is trying to get their act together in Europe. They missed the deadline on Sunday. They're going to meet again on Monday. Very dicey situation, as we know. If they don't get it together, it'll be default. But what I've seen is that the Greece instability is going to be part, is the tip of the spear of various things that are going to happen. In the other main arena of troubles is, of course, the Middle East with Iran and Israel. And now Pakistan says if Iran attacks, takes action against Israel, then Pakistan will respond. Okay. Pakistan responds. Everybody gets pulled into it. World War III. And away we go. As you would expect, right? If you've been watching, if you've been paying attention, you will know that this is exactly what you would expect from a situation of these times. I've predicted it. It's playing out. I've seen it happening. And it is going to happen. So what do we do? What do we do? We get near the exits. We get near the exits. Okay, so I am recording this also, so it can be downloaded. We're here in the studio, just as a way of giving you some background here. We're at a home studio on location, as it were, outside. You streaming this, using a webcam. Don't have the lights on yet. You can still see me, I think, pretty well. So I don't need to turn the lights on. Very simple, very simple. You should be able to view this online at Ustream. Clarity Ross is the channel. Christ Clarity is the channel. Okay, Christ Clarity is the channel you're watching this on. Now we opened up with a few events, world events that are taking place. That's for a reason, because all of these world events are going to unfold. It's scripted. Okay, it is scripted. It is designed to unfold in a particular way. And if you've been watching my videos on YouTube, on the channels Christ Clarity, Clarity Ross, Repent and Relocate, and Cool Down Place, you're getting a pretty good idea of the teaching I've been giving out. The teaching I've been giving out is designed to provide you with the clarity you need to make the choices that you need. So you will understand what's going on, so you'll be able to say, you know what, I really don't need to follow this game. Okay, so this is a very symbolic time. Namaste and Om and Aloha and all of that. Welcoming you to this video. I forgot to do that, but I guess people, you know, Namaste. Okay, welcome, welcome, welcome. We're sidestepping the Super Bowl. What is the Super Bowl? It's a violent game, isn't it? It's a game of tremendous violence and brutality and intensity. It's a war, essentially. It's a war by proxy. Sort of a reality-based type of game where it's not real, but it's close to real. And they're symbolically acting out a battle. That's what football's all about. And everybody knows that. Everybody knows that. It's gambling. It's violence. It's decadence, is everything that the ego loves and is teaching you. So, we're sidestepping that. We're not paying attention to it. No radio, no television here. I guess we can check the scores online if we want to, but it's not really necessary. We're not really following each and every play. And the game is underway right now, right as I'm speaking. It's incredible that here we are not even paying attention to it. Well, this is an analogy. This is a practice for not paying attention to the conflicts that are going to come up in the world. Because conflicts will take place in this planet, very severe. The key to sidestepping those is to not care what happens, not to try and keep a scorecard, not to try. So one day you can say, oh yeah, I remember that Tom Brady hit Gronkowski over the middle for 15 yards on a fourth down play and they were able to score the winning touchdown, blah, blah, blah. Now you don't need to know that. You don't need to know the final score, the final outcome. You don't need to know the plays, how many running yards, how many passing yards, how many bombs, how many people were killed, what country was against what other country, what the alliances were. You don't need to know any of that stuff. Completely unnecessary. And that is the key to your salvation. That is the key to sidestepping the whole situation, is you don't care what happened because you know what is happening. You know the big picture. The little details don't matter. Okay. If you see a big river, you don't need to measure the water flow in the river. You don't need to measure how fast the river is flowing, the cubic amount of cubic inches or yards or whatever, gallons that are flowing. You don't need to measure exactly how wide it is, what the slope of the river is. None of these things. You see the big river and you're saying, how do I get across that river? Or, you know, whatever question you have, you don't need to know anything about this, what's taking place on this planet, because all of it is designed for one thing only. Everything that happens here is designed to teach spirit how to die. And spirit cannot die. So everything that happens here is a waste of time. It's meaningless. It's futile. Has no meaning. Therefore, you don't have to keep track of it. Prime Creator is not going to ask you, Spirit, what happened on Earth there? Can you give me a blow-by-blow description? And who are the good guys and who are the bad guys and how did it all play out? Now, there won't be any questions whatsoever. They will just be, so Spirit, you finally realize that you can't die, huh? Very good. So now you can get on truly living the way you were created to live instead of trying to kill yourself, instead of trying to learn how to die. Because you're invulnerable, you're imperishable, your eternal life cannot die. So that is why you don't have to pay attention to what's going on here. Because nobody of any authority or consequence is ever going to ask you. You might feel guilty, like we are now. It's like, oh, it's terrible, we're not watching the Super Bowl. You know, so many people are watching it, right? So many, many, many people, and we're not watching it. You know, well, that's just awful. Guilty. Guilty is charged. We're guilty is charged. And at some point, people will look at you also, those who are in the world, thinking, ah, how could those people possibly sidestep all of this? They don't know what's taking place here. They're losing out on all this valuable, valuable information. But the truth is, all of this scenario that's playing out is simply the attempt on the part of the ego, which is really the mind presenting the idea to spirit of how can spirit die and then become prime creator by ending its association with the prime creator, and so that it can then become the prime creator. That's why all of this activity that you see in the world is designed to teach spirit how to die. Very simple teaching is that we are spirit, we're an extension of being. God, the prime creator, created being and then extended that being. That's called creation, extension of being. We are the extension of being. We're part of that extension of being, part of God's, the prime creator's creation. Only God, the prime creator, can create being. The extension of being cannot create being. It can only extend it. That is what creation manifestation is, the extension of being. Spirit had the idea that it wanted to create being. But how can it do that? Because it's already an extension of being. That's what it is. So somehow it would have to separate from God, the prime creator. In order to do that, it would have to die. What it's come up with is that somehow it has to die. has to not be what it is, has to cease being what it is, so that it can then claim that it's now the prime creator and then create being. Impossible. Cannot happen. And yet, spirit has mind as the presenter of ideas to spirit. It's the creative function of spirit. And that spirit took this idea and said, mind, I want you to find a way to accomplish this. So now mind says, being the perfect servant, says, okay, here we go. Massive imagination that mind has thrown up, projecting like on a screen, like a movie screen. All this is a projection that you're seeing of spiritual imagination, of mind's imagination. Supremely creative and clever, and has created a vast, vast, vast learning experience for spirit. Spirit is observing this. Mind has even created a learner too, or not created, but imagined a learner. And the learner is learning these lessons of how to die. Every human being, every body is simply a learning device. We identify with this learning device. Spirit identifies with this learning device, hoping that by identifying with it, it's going to learn something from the body. It's going to learn how to die, because of course the body dies, it gets sick, deteriorates, is vulnerable. I mean, every breath, we're just one, you know, breath away from dying, aren't we? If our breath gets stopped, we die very quickly, pass out and die. We're vulnerable to getting hit. I almost got hit in a parking lot today. Wasn't paying good enough attention, and the driver wasn't either. People are distracted these days. So we're extremely vulnerable. If 1 second of inattention can result in body dying. So spirit is avidly watching all of this, avidly watching what's taking place with all these bodies, because it believes that it can learn how to die from these bodies. These bodies will teach it how to die. That's literally what's taking place when spiritual teachers say, don't identify with the body. They never say why. I'm saying why. Because the body is literally a learning, teaching device that supposedly is teaching us how to die. Us meaning spirit. The reason why you disidentify with the body is because spirit cannot die. It's a complete waste of time to identify with the body. The body can never teach spirit anything at all. Body is vulnerability, the spirit is invulnerable. The body dies, the spirit is immortal, cannot die. Completely different. Spirit cannot become something other than what it is. It cannot learn how to be something other than what it is, which is an extension of being. These are very simple plays I'm calling out to you. You're the quarterback. I'm the coach. You're the quarterback. I'm calling in these plays to you. And you should say, yeah, I get it. I get it. A very simple one is, we are an extension of being and we're trying to create being. Mind is a servant of spirit. It presents a scenario of trying to teach spirit how to die. This scenario is what we call the universe. We identify with the body, then we think we're the body for the purpose of trying to learn how to die. But the body is not what we are at all. It's got nothing to do with what we are. Complete fantasy, just a hypothetical, made-up scenario. So we don't need to identify with the body. We don't need to know what the body is doing, what the persona is doing, the personality, which is what the non-dual gurus are telling us, you know, that you just don't have to identify or pay attention to the workings of the mind, the persona. It's not important. It's just very true. It's not important. Each life here in the world is completely meaningless, without any importance, because its only objective is to teach spirit how to die. Now, of course, it's very complicated, very diverse. All this diversity, you see, is not the diversity of God trying to just experience all different sorts of experiences, not at all. Neither is it God trying to just keep spirit from getting bored by giving us all sorts of drama. Not true. All the diversity here is because spirit cannot learn how to die, and so as long as it keeps wanting to, it has to mind has to keep spinning out massive types of diversity, all different types. And so mind can say, look, you haven't got it yet, but look at all these other things you haven't done yet. And by doing that, you will surely get it. So there's literally infinite variety of dying in the universe. Everything here is impermanent. Everything is decaying. Everything is turning into dust, and then dust is being being constructed again, pulled together again into constructs, forms, which then are torn down again. Ceaseless. And you think about it, you couldn't have a scenario of dying unless something was so born first. So you have to have all these forms, life forms, so to speak, being born, being constructed, being built up, so that then they can be torn down and eventually die. That's why I say this universe is the play of constructivity and destructivity, which is one really two-sided dynamic. You can't have destructivity without constructivity. It's impossible. And since the purpose of this existence is to try and teach spirit how to die, you have to then have constructivity, all these forms constantly being built up. 7 billion people on the planet right now, and virtually all of them are devotees of death. They're all here to try and learn the final lesson. They're eager for it. Many are very eager for it. There's a few who are not so eager for it, and you should be one of those. You're watching this. I never was eager for death. I could stand it. I didn't come here to learn the lessons of death, which is why when I saw anything die, I was absolutely shocked and appalled and traumatized. Any harm to anything completely traumatized me. I said, whoa, I didn't come here to pay attention to that. This is way out of line. So I always feel like a complete stranger to this world of death. Death is like completely foreign to me. I don't relate to it at all. So I certainly knew what was going on in this world, but the overwhelming devotion of the people of this planet to death, trying to learn how to die, is so strong that I simply got pressurized in it from every possible angle, and I spent all my time dodging all this pressure, and eventually I succumbed to a certain extent. Just like went into depression, basically, because I said, you know, how can you, these people here are such fanatical devotees of the ego satsang of death that they don't pay attention to anything I'm saying. And to a certain extent, that's still true, although some are paying attention. Some are getting it. They're waking up. They're saying, yeah, because time is getting short and no more time to procrastinate. We're finding out now. Who are the procrastinators and who are the ones who decide to go for it? Because it's time to go for it. That's why I'm doing these videos. It is time. There's no more time to procrastinate because the ego is going to put on what I call an altar call. I view this world like a vast satsang. The ego satsang of death is what I call it. A satsang is where those who are seeking an answer go and sit with one who professes to have an answer. And it's a very very important, intensely focused situation. And you're trusting that the one you're listening to truly knows the answer. We have those who are gurus of truth here in this world, and they hold satsangs, and people come there to understand the truth about our true reality, which is spirit untouched by dreams of its destruction. Well, in this world, the ego is holding a vast satsang for 7 billion people, a satsang of death. The ego is a generic term used to refer to the sum total of all marketing strategies that mind is using to try and convince spirit that it can die. All those strategies, so many. We just lump all those strategies together for convenience of speech and say that's the ego. Okay, so the ego is putting on this satsang of death, where everybody is here in this world, 7 billion people are paying attention to what's happening on the planet. And the drums are beating, you know. The drums are beating for a vast conflagration, vast battle, vast amount of destructivity, negation, combat, war, privation, destitution, starvation, sickness, all of the bad stuff. The ego is going to put on this satsang, and then the devotees of death are going to pay a great deal of attention to it. And at the end, right now we're at what's called the altar call. When you have a satsang, you have an intensive, maybe it lasts 1 week, 2 weeks, And you build up, build up, and build up towards the last day. And the last day, the guru says, okay, everybody, come on up here and tell me what you've learned over this intensive. And then people come up and testify. Same thing with religious revivals, marketing, you know, seminars, motivational seminars. A motivational speaker at the end, they say, everybody, come on up on stage. Those of you who get it, you know, those who are committed, come on up and sing the praises of what you found out. The ego does the exact same thing. It's been holding these intense satsangs of death for a long time now, ratcheting up the pressure more and more and more and more in this world. And now we're getting to the point where the altar call will be made, and the ego is going to say, okay, all of those who have committed to destructivity, it's time for you to prove that you have truly committed to this. And then people, the whole situation will be activated. Now, there is a guru of destructivity functioning with this planet right now. It's functioning on the psychic level. I don't know if they have a body here or strictly on the psychic level. I call this the goddess of destructivity, because I call it that because I was present when this dynamic was released onto this planet. It was on the psychic level, subtle level. And I was present. I saw this figure. It was a feminine, female figure with long dark hair and a ferocious, absolutely frozen fury, ferocious attitude and focused will and intent. Unbelievably, 100% focused. Intent on activating destructivity on this planet. So this is literally the guru of destructivity, that is the charismatic guru figure, the motivational speaker, the leader of the satsang. And what this being is going to do is going to, on the psychic level, is going to put out an intense call, a psychic call that influences everybody who's been pre-programmed to respond to this will respond. And the intent will be, okay, let's start the destructivity now, wave after wave. She's going to be like an orchestra leader, triggering, you know, orchestrating the whole thing. Okay, you now, you play here, you do this, you do that, you do that, you do that. The world is like a vast orchestra, and this is the orchestra leader. And the altar call is this being psychically saying, okay, everyone, time to prove your merit, time to prove your loyalty, time to learn the lessons, to activate the lessons that you came here to activate. It's go time. And she will put out that psychic message. I don't think it's going to be on television or radio or magazines or books or anything, social media or anything. It's at the psychic level. Okay, its level is in the mind, and the mind is joined. It's not separate. It's the ultimate social media, ultimate gadget. And so you can broadcast something psychically, and the entire world will pick it up. Those who are sensitive to it will certainly pick it up. And what the ego has done is it's pre-programmed people at the subtle subconscious level in this world to respond to this altar call of destructivity. And so very soon, excuse me, okay, very soon this call will be given out on the psychic level, and responses will come, and it will be orchestrated. War, World War III, tremendous troubles here. And people are chomping at the bit for this. It's go time. That's why it's go time for us right here. Very important. I was watching Muji's satsangs the last couple weeks from Tiruvannamalai. Very interesting. He also gave out impassioned plea. He says, you know, now's the time. Don't wait. It's very important. He didn't say it the way I'm saying it, but he did. It did seem like he has a tremendous urgency. Come on, everyone. He says, you got to get it right now. And that's true. That's right. You've got to get it right now. What does get it mean, though? Do you have to truly disidentify 100% from the body, from the world. That's one way of doing it. I don't believe you have to go quite that far, because many are sort of manufacture an emotional experience, a mental experience to please the guru, but it's not lasting, it's not truly true awakening, and maybe some time is lost by doing that. What's important is that you get near the exits of the satsang hall, the ego satsang of death. You get near the exits of that. You get away from the altar. You get near the exit. And then you listen to that which is most helpful to you, that gives you the greatest boost. And I'm trying to do my part. I am doing my part here. And telling you that the key to sidestepping all of this terrible, terrible lesson in how to die, which is futile and a waste of your time, is to realize you don't need to keep score. You don't need to know what happened, who hit who, you know. It's like a fight, you know, in second grade, and the kids are squabbling, you know, and you just say, well, and the teacher says, well, who hit who, you know, who started it, you know, who said the bad word, who instigated, you know. You don't need to get into that. If you're wise, you know, you just say, I don't care, you know, a couple of fools couldn't turn the other cheek, and so they got agitated and aggravated and blah, blah. Who cares? Doesn't matter. Because it's all coming from the same source, that is desire to be prime creator, a desire to learn how to die. All parties involved have that desire. Both the good, the bad, and the ugly, okay, all have the same desire. The quote-unquote good, the constructives, are there to get beat on by the destructive, so there will be casualties and sacrifices. The truly wise sidestep it all. They're not interested in being martyrs or heroes at all. Heroes for what? That's the thing. If you stay focused on this planet, you're going to be dragged down. You're going to be... The atmosphere here will be one of intense focus on conflict. It will be an all-out absorption in this. Because the majority of people on this planet, I would say the large majority, are profoundly interested in trying to learn the lessons from all this conflict. And they absolutely hate any attempt to distract them from it. You may think that you're trying to do a good deed by saying, hey, you know, over here, look over here, I want to tell you something, come on this way, you can escape from it. No, they don't want that. They will look at you ferociously, like you are depriving them of what is most essential for them, because they believe that these lessons of death, defeat, conflict, etc., are absolutely key for their spirit to learn how to die, and from that dying, they believe, will come a new birth, a new creation, a new being, that that spirit will create a new being from the death, from its death, and they will be now, spirit will be prime creator. That's what they believe, deep down. And so by distracting them, they feel as if you are depriving them of that, and they will be furious with you. You'll be the first one to go. They'll dispatch you post-haste, believe me. And if you refuse to be killed, they'll send you to a re-education place. That's the truth of these times. There are some who, here on this planet, who really, really aren't interested in all of this. Those are the wise ones. But their number is very small in comparison to those who are profoundly fixated on it. So, the numbers are so overwhelming that the idea that somehow you can stand in the way of this avalanche and stop it are ridiculous. Cannot. Doesn't matter how peaceful you are. The idea that somehow a peaceful being can be here and everyone will just stop is a very foolish thing. It's at best, it's a very temporary expedient. One of my great gurus, Sri Anandamayi Ma, would go to the Kumbh Mela in India, and there would be warring factions of spiritual aspirants, various... There's a lot of different factions in India of spiritual paths, teachers, lineages, etc. And they have different precepts, different ideas. When they get together for the Kumbh Mela, the vast jamboree of spiritual aspirants, sadhus and holy people, etc., conflicts break out. disagreements, arguments. So when she would go there, what they would do, they'd pitch a big tent, and she would sit in the tent and would invite these various leaders, squabbling factions, into the tent. And they'd just sit there quietly, and maybe she'd chat with them and laugh, smile, and inquire about their lives, etc. And the peace was so profound that they would completely forget what they were fighting about. And they'd walk out of the tent hugging each other or whatever, and, full of love for one another, very peaceful and happy, and they had no idea what they're fighting about. But then, a little later on, they'd be right back at it. Just a very temporary expedient, really. And that was the most peaceful being, a most peaceful being doing that. And extraordinarily rare. So it's not possible for you to stand in the way of your brothers and sisters here who want negation, want the lessons, because their will is just as powerful as your will. Your will is not more powerful. Those who choose non-negation and realize, give up the attempt to be prime creator, they don't have a stronger will than the other aspects of spirit. It's all equal. Those who want to continue on with their lessons are using their will to do this. They're determined. That's their will. Their fixation is from their will, their willingness. You can't override that. You might charm them for a little while, might give them a taste of peace, but suddenly they'll realize, wait a minute, I'm missing my conflict. We're missing our football game. You may even be thinking that right now. You're saying, what's this? Clarity Ross is distracting me from my football game. I got to get back to it. Except this is better than a football game, isn't it? What you're hearing now, you may have never heard before, but on the football game, you've seen it all before. How many Super Bowls have you seen, really? But this here, the first live broadcast on Ustream you've never seen before. It has content you've never heard before. And it's easy for me to say this because I spent my life working on saying it. But it's not so easy for other people because I say the goddess of destructivity, the chief guru of the on this planet of the egos, satsang of death, she is very formidable, very ferocious, very focused, 100% focused on the psychic level. So you cannot approach the situation at the psychic level because you will be intimidated there. On the psychic level, the world is very intimidated. It's in a straitjacket. It's in a stranglehold. It cannot function well at that level right now, which is why it's very important that you spent time on the spiritual path, realizing something higher than the psychic level. Psychic level is still there for you, but it is profoundly influenced by everything that's taking place in the world. And the intense will to conflict, intensely affected by that. I know those who are very psychic, open to the psychic, and they are suffering horribly right now, almost dying, simply from the vibrations that are being put out right now. And the goddess of destructivity is the head guru, but she also has many, many, many of those under her who are amplifying, sub-amplifiers, substations, as it were, amplifying her will, as she calls the world, into conflict. Because people of their own accord, we of our own accord, are not going to be so rash to rush into conflict. We would rather say, wait a minute, we have something better. We can, attend a satsang of a teacher of truth. We can read a teaching of truth. We can read A Course in Miracles. We can attend a satsang of Muji, for instance. Those are just two examples. There are many others. And this is better use of our time. We don't need to build up any sort of conflict or animosity or agitation toward others. We can be in a forgiving mind at all times. We can let everything pass, turn the other cheek. That's the teachings of Jesus Christ in the Bible. That's the teachings of many teachers throughout history. Love your enemy is very important. There's a deeper significance to that. Love your enemy. Very deep significance, because as you extend love, you realize that you are love, and love is endless. As you extend loving your enemy, you are aware of your endlessness, which is your true being, which is... Okay. we just lost our connection, but we're back up. I'm saying to extend endlessness to every facet, whatever comes up for you, extend it. If you're enlightened, extend endlessness to enlightenment. If you're unenlightened, extend endlessness to unenlightenment. Say I'm willing for that unenlightenment to be there endlessly. Extend it to every situation, positive, negative. I'm willing to have this conflict, this tension in the world, be there endlessly. I'm willing to have the peace in the world be there endlessly. By doing this, you are literally re-establishing the fact of endlessness, which is literally what your identity is. So you're literally re-establishing awareness of what your identity really is. Because what is anything to endlessness? What is a mood? What is a passing weather pattern to endlessness? It doesn't affect endlessness at all, does it? Nothing affects endlessness. And it's very important for you to acknowledge that. When you see the attacks taking place, when you see the struggles, when you see your own failures, like let's say you go to a satsang, like Muji satsang, and not everybody gets it. You know, some seem to maybe get something. Many maybe don't. But they say, well, I extend this failure to awaken endlessly. I'm willing to have that arise in endlessness, to be endless. I don't put any limit on it. I don't try to stop it. Open-ended. This can be there endlessly. This failure to awaken can be there endlessly. This desire to leave can be there endlessly. I love this. I will love this desire, failure endlessly. I will love failure to awaken endlessly. I'll love this failure to understand endlessly. This is the real enlightened approach. This is the true approach that actually will work for you. There was a book back in the 60s, maybe early 70s, called The Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment by Thaddeus Golis. And it was really on track in many ways. Many, many people read it. And that's one of the Western key books or Western teachings of the time where people started resonating and started tuning in to truth. And it was, love it the way it is. Love everything exactly the way it is. Don't try to change anything. The attempt to change it is not going to work for you. Whatever is, whatever is arising for you, simply love it the way it is. In other words, extend, be willing for that to be there endlessly. And you may say, well, I'll get bored of it. No, because endlessness transcends anything that takes place in endlessness. It's a very key concept. In other words, the feeling of what you are will be there as long as you acknowledge that it's endless. As soon as you get involved in trying to stop something, you are reinforcing the notion of something ending, okay, which is what this universe is all about. It's about endings, isn't it? It's literally trying to kill yourself. I mean, spirit is trying to learn how to die, how to end, okay? So the way to turn it around, the way to make a turnaround, which is what we need to do right now, the turnaround is to extend endlessness to everything. I'm willing to have this planet here endlessly. I'm willing to have all the conflict and on this planet continue endlessly. I'm willing for all the pollution to continue endlessly. I'm willing for all the genetic modifications of our food to continue endlessly. I'm willing to love that endlessly. And you will very soon feel this feeling of transcendence. It's a different feeling. It's like, wow. Wow. I am endless. Nothing can touch me. Nothing can really touch me. What can touch endlessness? Consider that. Can the pollution here touch endlessness? Cannot. But you have to affirm that fact. And the way to affirm it, like Jesus said, love your enemies. That is the key to all his teaching and the teaching of salvation. Love your enemies. That's a practical program of practice. You see someone, here's your enemy, say, I'm willing for that person to be my enemy endlessly, just exactly the way they are. I don't need for them to change in the slightest bit. That person who cut me off while I'm driving on the freeway, I'm willing for them to cut me off like that endlessly. And I love that, willing to love that endlessly. I'm willing to love the fact that somebody's driving too fast and almost hit me. I'm willing to love that endlessly. I'm willing to love the fact I'm exhausted. I'm willing to allow that to be endlessly, just exactly the way it is, no change. I'm sick. I'm willing to allow that sickness to be there endlessly. I give it full endlessness. By doing that, you're giving yourself full being, aren't you? Beingness. And that is more profound than anything that is arising within that beingness, projected into it. And of course, you're also willing for other things to arise and endlessness. Eventually, you'll be willing to decide that endlessness, extension of endlessness, is all you really want, and then you'll give up the attempt to learn how to die, and then all this conflict and stuff will not need to arise at all. And yet, whether it arises or not, that doesn't bother you in the slightest bit, doesn't even touch you. This is what you see in the great gurus, avatars, the saviors of this planet, of us. They come in here and they have that attitude. Sri Nandamayi Ma had that attitude. Absolutely, she was not bothered by anything that ever took place. She was not trying to change anything that took place. She was happy, completely happy, no matter what. Doesn't matter what was taking place. She said, come what may, you know, let it come. Doesn't matter. Because though that which knows the identity, spirit that knows that its identity is endless extension of being, they are not insecure at all about anything that's happening to a body or any happening anywhere, happening to a planet, happening to a universe, doesn't matter. Because that too arises in the endlessness of their being, of their extended being. So we here need to practice that, and that is one of the key practices. That's the really heart of the practice that was just shown to me just a little while ago. And when I saw it, I said, you know what, that's a lot like Thaddeus Golis, the lazy man's guide to enlightenment. He got that basically from using drugs, which at the time a lot of spiritual aspirants were using drugs, and so it was a little distorted. It wasn't crystal clear. This here is coming straight from clarity, and there's no drugs involved, and it's coming from inner prompting of the Holy Spirit. The spirit that knows its wholeness, its endlessness, it can still communicate with itself, can advise itself. It doesn't need to go through the ego to advise us. It can go straight to us and say, try this, try this. Try to simply allow whatever arises to be endlessly loved by you, to be endlessly accepted, to be endlessly present. If you don't want to say love, that's fine. But you can have a feeling. It's a feeling. It's not emotional love or affection. No, you don't have to have affection for it. It's bigger than that. It's that you literally give it permission to remain in your present for endlessly. Endlessly. That's the greatest love, isn't it? That's what real true love is whatever is there. It's allowed. You give it full allowance to be there forever, endlessly. Longer than forever, endlessly. A couple of cats are walking right past here. Maybe they want to attend the satsang. Hello, kitties. All right. Well, they're very relaxed, aren't they? See, I'm willing for them to be here. What they're doing, endlessly. They're just walking past now, enjoying the day, late afternoon. They're not watching the Super Bowl either. Yeah. They're just going about their play. And I'm willing for them to go about their play endlessly. For that play to continue on endlessly. Doesn't need to change. As soon as you try to change something, you're trying to stop something. As soon as you try to stop something, you're denying your true identity. As soon as you deny your true identity, you got no choice but to try to learn how to die. Because you'll have to then replace it. If you don't know what you are, you're literally trying to replace what you are. There's no other motive for not knowing what you are. None. So only desire to be prime creator gives rise to the attempt for spirit to learn how to die, to forget what it is. Not only forget, but to completely negate what it is so it can never remember. Because if spirit imagine this. If spirit wants to be prime creator, spirit can say, I'm the new prime creator. That is what I am. How can spirit remember then that it's not prime creator, that's an extension of spirit? It cannot. That would cancel out its belief that it is a new prime creator. So it has to negate what it is. So it doesn't remember it. So there's no zero awareness of what it is, that it's gone forever. Only then can spirit believe that it can now feel safe to be prime creator. It won't remember what it used to be, so to speak. So spirit gets caught in this dynamic of not knowing what it is. Actually, it's literally trying to get rid of itself, kill itself. So if spirit doesn't know what it is, what its true identity is, that means it's trying to be prime creator, trying to destroy itself. Guaranteed that's what it is. I saw something yesterday. A man got up on stage and he was a jokester. And he said, you know, I went to church. I don't like going to church. You know why? Because I don't like to be surrounded by so many sinners. And he got kind of a chuckle from some. Some didn't laugh about that, though. The idea of being a sinner, original sin, is a very, very good teaching, actually, because everyone that comes to this planet, every body you see in this planet, is being identified with spirit for the purpose of trying to learn how to die. The attempt for spirit to replace the prime creator is the original sin. It means it's an idea that can never be experienced. And it's missing the mark. Sin means to miss the mark. It's off track. It's off track. Spirit getting off track. Spirit trying to be prime creator is getting off track. So everyone on this planet, everybody you see, there's a spirit identifying with that body. There's an aspect of spirit identifies with that body. And it's off track. It's trying to learn how to die, which is a sin, sinful. It's missing the mark. So those who go to church, those who attend religious services, those who pray on their own, those who realize that they need to make a change. They realize that they're right now off track. They're sinful. Those are the wise ones. Those are the ones who are being responsible. So to joke that you know, someone doesn't like going to church because they're surrounded by sinners is really kind of a foolish joke to make. Very much so. They may be even the worst sinner, because they may be that they don't want to change. They want to really fixate on how to die. Whereas those who are going to church may say, you know what, I don't really want to continue on with this fixation. So I really want to change. I want to listen to that which told me how to get free of this. And of course, the classic teachings are still completely true. Jesus said, love your enemy. That is the key to it, which is what he did. Turn the other cheek. He actually showed here in this world how to love your enemy, even to the point of being crucified. He still had nothing but love. He was willing to say, I'm willing for this crucifixion to remain present with me endlessly. Do you see that? And by keeping that attitude all the way through, you see, he was easily resurrected, easily came back from the dead, because he was willing for that death to be with him in his beingness eternally, endlessly. So he never forgot what his true identity was, which is endlessness. And there's no death of endlessness. There's no end to endlessness. So, simply, death retreated from his body. That's a fact. And that's something that anyone who accepts their true identity can also do that. Don't need to do that. Don't need to be a martyr. That was an extreme example to showcase to the world the truth about reality, about our true identity, and the fact that we're trying to destroy our true identity, and that their true identity cannot be destroyed. Hello, cat. Showcase for us, and his teaching is, of course, love your enemy. People are saying, what are you talking about? Well, now we know. Now the key has been given out. Hopefully it's been given out before. I haven't really been able to find those who, you know, truly understand this. But it was just given to me very recently, saying this is how you do it. You'd be willing to love everything exactly the way it is, even love those who are crucifying you. Love to the extent that you're willing to have this, whatever's taking place, you're willing to have that continue taking place endlessly. You're not trying to stop anything from taking place. You're not trying to bring an ending to anything. Which is then reaffirms what you really are, which is endlessness. And in endlessness, there's no death, there's no ending. So in you, there's no ending, no death. So you cannot die, you cannot perish. And then you're free from trying to teach yourself how to die. Ultimately, you're free because you give up the idea. You decide, I don't want to be prime creator because I'm an extension of being. God is the prime creator. I'm the prime created. And that's perfect because it's endless. How can you say it's not perfect if it's endless? You see? You can't put a quality on endlessness. You can't define it. Infinite riches, right? Endlessness. The extension is endless. There's no end to it. The universe, there's an end to it. The universe is simply a dream arising in endlessness. That's a fact. How long the game's been going on? 4.5 hours. No, it started 4:30, so it's been 1 hour so far broadcasting. Very good. We're doing fine. What do we have here? Yeah, we're doing great. I haven't added in a bunch of bells and whistles. I'd say let's just do a straight broadcast, but it's possible to add in some bells and whistles here. Some music. I could have a music. I could put some music on if you want to do that. Let me see if you'll allow me. I will see if I can pull up a. Add music. Okay. Let me see if I can find something here. I think I'll be able to do this. Give me just a minute here. I don't know what's going on in the football game. Honest, I have not looked anywhere. Oops, I can't do it because my... okay, very good. Cannot do it. My external hard drive is back in the room. So I have to load these songs, load stuff onto my laptop here in order to do that. That's okay. We'll keep on keeping on here. Game's been going for 1 hour, and we've been going strong here. Hello, cat. I have one entity attending the satsang here, which is my cat, a very wonderful cat. It's the miracle cat who was hit by a truck, and everyone thought the cat was dead. It was lying there like dead. And after several minutes, someone picked it up, was carrying it to set it down somewhere, and suddenly the cat woke up and ran away and didn't come home. And we all thought the cat was dead. We were looking for it. We could never find it. And then in the middle of the night, the cat came home through the cat door. And we thought it would be, you know, just terribly injured. But all it had was a slight limp. And it recovered within several days. It was 100%. And it's been, you know, not a trace of being smashed by... The truck was going like 40 miles an hour. Just smashed the cat. Wasn't harmed at all. So we call this cat our miracle cat. It's a wonderful cat. You might even say the cat was resurrected. I mean, by all accounts, the cat should have been dead. And everyone thought it was. So someone saw it and picked the cat up and said, oh my gosh. Okay, cat. Wonderful. So, I appreciate the miracle cat here. Very peaceful, very blissful cat. Very intelligent, too. So, the game is going on right now, and we are continuing on with this incredible information, giving out the keys to salvation. What does salvation mean? It means being saved from the terrible lessons of trying to die, trying to learn how to die. You're saved from that. You no longer have to attend those classes, those lessons, the satsang of death, of the ego. You don't have to attend that anymore. And if you're there, you don't have to pay any more attention to it. If you're in the classroom, as we are, here we have a body we're identifying with. It's our little death buddy that we're paying attention to. We don't have to really pay attention to it anymore in that way. What is the body thinking? Doesn't matter. What are the thoughts it's thinking? Doesn't matter. What are its intentions? Doesn't matter. We don't have to really keep tabs on it because we're not learning anything from it anymore, you see? There's nothing to learn from it. That's the real key. A little cloudy evening here in California. A little bit cool. Very peaceful, though. I like the tape outside. You have the birds, you have the chimes, you have the wind, the air, the atmosphere, the peacefulness, It's tremendous. Maybe some birds will come attend a satsang. I don't know. Is there any birds around here? Yeah. Satsang with Clarity Ross here. This is a satsang about how to leave the ego satsang. Beautiful place. Very fortunate. I have this opportunity here. Holy Spirit has a lot of grace. Doesn't always work in ways we understand, that's for sure. Don't sell it short. I know a lot of times I get frustrated because I ask for, you know, help and don't get it. It always acts in mysterious ways, ways you don't anticipate or expect. And when it doesn't meet your expectation, you may be, you know, thinking, oh, I've been forsaken. And then suddenly you'll get something, you know, like, oh, all you need to do is love everything the way it is and be willing for it to be present in its format endlessly. And that will literally help you transcend everything that's taking place on this planet. Say, huh, I guess that's pretty good. That's pretty good, great grace right there, isn't it? And then, you know, the things that you need, they appear. Wireless connection just appeared. I didn't ask for it. Everything that I need to do this is here. You know, it's pretty amazing. I really wasn't even thinking about doing this, and it just somehow it just all fit together on its own. Making this available to the world, saying the things that many are not able to say, even though they believe it, they know it is true. The ability to say it here requires that you have some capability to withstand the psychic attacks of the goddess of destructivity here, who works at the psychic level. She's very ferocious. She's so ferocious that she can freeze you. Really, I almost got frozen up by her ferocity. Her coldness is unbelievable coldness. Does not acknowledge your presence at all. Does not respond to your communication, trying to engage like, hey, you know, it must be a better way than what you're doing. No, zero willingness to do that. It freezes you up, you know, it's very, very intimidating. So a lot of people now are frozen up. They're afraid to say anything. They're afraid to comment on the videos. They're afraid to communicate. And I don't know, it seems to me like that needs to, the ice needs to be broken. And you just need to do a shout out and say, hey, this is great, I really like it. And you cannot remain paralyzed continuously. But if you are, then what you do is you'd be willing to allow that situation of being paralyzed to be there in your be there endlessly. Complete willingness for it to be there endlessly. Just do that. Say, okay, I'm willing to be uncommunicative, non-communicative endlessly. I'm willing to be frozen up with fear endlessly. I'm willing to be intimidated endlessly. Extend that attitude toward it. See how magnanimous that is? And you say, wow, I must be a tremendous being to be able to extend endlessness to these situations. It's amazing, 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 amazing how quickly that will change your attitude and mood. Don't oppose anything that arises, okay? And you do have to practice it. I mean, I've had a hard, difficult time. I've struggled with it. I've forgotten it several times. I've really forgotten it. You see, you know, but as we practice it here, you will more and more find out how easy it is. And as soon as you start feeling negative and saying, I'm failing, immediately say, ah, I'm willing to embrace that failure, willing for that failure to be present endlessly, endlessly, no end to it, endlessly. Give that endlessness to it. Be willing to extend endlessness to this failure. And suddenly, instead of feeling the failure, you're feeling endlessness, which is your true identity. And you're not even aware of any failure anymore, are you? Just like that. It's like a miracle medicine. So when people say, thank you, Jesus, they're onto something, aren't they? And it's a lot of people, the ego has conditioned people to hate Jesus for some reason, because the ego is profoundly frightened by Jesus, profoundly frightened, because Jesus gave the simple advice of how to get free from the ego, and the ego says, oh, if you do that, you won't learn how to die. Oh, you won't learn how to die whether you do it or not. Futility is still futility. Whether you stay in futility or not, it's still futile. So it's stupid to listen to the ego, you know. But again, love your stupidity. Love the fact that you hate Jesus and be willing to have that hatred there endlessly. And then you'll feel the endlessness and you'll say, I really like this feeling of endlessness. And then you realize that Jesus was simply pointing to that endlessness by saying, love your enemy. And then you'll say, well, Jesus wasn't so bad after all. In fact, he's right on track. But like again, if you feel hostile toward Jesus, that's perfect too. Say, I'm willing to have that hostility toward Jesus there. I'm willing to have it there endlessly. And right away, you'll feel that endlessness. And you say, wow, that's fantastic. And if you dislike a guru, that's okay. Say, I'm willing for that dislike to be there endlessly. You might get agitated. I hate that guru. He's trying to put a scam over on us all or something. Say, I'm willing to have that hatred, that distrust there endlessly. I'm willing to have that skepticism there endlessly. I'm willing to have that atheism there endlessly. It's okay if you're an atheist. You can say, just say, I'm willing to have that scornful atheism there endlessly. Or even non-scornful atheism. I'm willing to have that there endlessly. Not a problem. Not a problem at all. If I have to take a break here, I'll just hit this blank shot here like this. You see? And then here we are. We're back. You see how that works? So if there's any interruptions, which there might be, because I'm outside here, I can always hit that blank thing and take a break, but I'll let you know. If that happens, I might say, well, I'm going to take a 5-minute break. But as it is now, I'm rolling pretty good. And we're already through about an hour and 15 minutes of the Super Bowl. Seeing if I can keep this going. I have some coconut juice here. I'm going to have a little bit of this just to wet the whistle here. Very good coconut juice. Psycho. Coconut juice is very good for you, I think. I don't know. Oh, cat. The cat is still wandering around. Actually, the reason why the cat is here is the cat wants to be fed, right? Right? Yeah, the cat wants to be fed. That's why he's hanging out here. You think the cat is coming for satsang? No, they're coming because they're hungry and they know you're the one to feed them. But in their own way, that is satsang, because for them, food is, you know, being fed is all important. And they know who's the one that feeds them. So they come very politely and sit very calmly and politely, knowing that they're going to be fed if they just hang in there long enough, which always happens. Although this one is very persistent. And if he doesn't get what he wants, he starts just crying. So he may start crying pretty soon. Just like that, we come to satsang, the satsang of truth in this world, because we're tired of trying to learn the lessons of the ego, trying to learn how to die. We're tired of it. It doesn't work. We know it doesn't work. We know it'll never work. And we don't know how in the world am I going to get back to that feeling of endlessness that I know is my true identity. And there again, love your enemy. Love everyone. Love everything just the way it is. We will practice that. It seems to be that will be the way that I teach, at least for now. I know in non-dual Advaita, like Ramana Maharshi taught, it's who's asking, who's the I, find out who I is. You know, that's a certain approach. I've never quite resonated with that approach. I've seen that it works, because in Muji Satsang, I saw how it works. I saw it very clearly. I didn't embrace it entirely, but I saw it. But the way that I teach, it comes more from the lineage of Jesus and Christ and A Course in Miracles and Sri Anandamayi Ma, who was the great example of loving everything exactly the way it is. She showed you it's possible to do it perfectly. It's very helpful to see someone who does it perfectly, and you realize, it really is possible. She didn't identify with any endings, any death at all. She said life and death were exactly the same. She embraced, was willing to have everything be exactly the way it was endlessly. someone being born, someone dying, same willingness to be for it to be just like that endlessly. And in seeing that, that says, wow, hey, it is possible. So she didn't give much teaching out, but that wasn't her purpose here. Her purpose was to showcase actually doing it here, which is very, very important. Jesus showcased it 2,000 years ago, too, very, very well. It's good to have modern updates to show that it's still possible, because with the advent of computational power here in this world, we think that that's a game changer, you see, that we think it's going to enable us somehow to empower us to learn our lessons in a far more profound manner here. So we have really, it's really knocked a lot of people out, to tell you the truth. But there again, love, if you're one of those who have been knocked out by that, be willing to be that knocked outness there endlessly. Just give it that endlessness, which is really loving it the way it is. And you will suddenly feel, you will soon feel, I'm really not so knocked out after all, am I? I'm resurrecting from the dead, from the lessons of trying to be dead, so to speak, because really, spirit cannot die. Cannot. Of course, bodies die all the time, but they were never alive in the first place. One of the teachings that Jesus has given out in A Course in Miracles is that whatever dies was never alive in the first place. Which is very true. Bodies are not alive in the first place. Not at all. They're just teaching devices. They're gadgets, if you will, gadgets. And now we have all these entities coming into this planet with all these gadgets. They come from a place called Gadgetland, I call it. They come from a realm, another place in the universe where gadgets are very central to their lives. Just their lives are super saturated with gadgets. They've reincarnated onto this planet and bringing their culture with them, their love of gadgets, which shows you they're just addicted to them, is unbelievable. They have to have the latest and the greatest gadget, and they'll line up ahead of time and fight each other for them and find out, try to get one first and be the most powerful, fastest gadget. You know, gadgets, gadgets, gadgets. And all this is causing people to say, oh my gosh, maybe there is some way that we can learn how to die if we just use all this computational power that's getting more and more exponentially growing. The fact is, it has no effect on the lesson of trying to die. It's still 100% futile. So it's meaningless. Waste of time. Waste of time. So it's easy for me, seeing that I can dismiss all of it. I can use simple technology that we have. I can use it in the right way, which is to broadcast this message to you. I have this nice, just cheap headset. I have a really cheap webcam. And I have a laptop with a mouse. And I have a wireless internet connection. And that's it. That's it. And then I have Ustream. And then you have your laptop and your headphones. And so because this technology is here, using it in the right way is appropriate. That's what we're doing. Using it to transmit the key to transcending it, which is to love it the way it is. So love the fact that all these gadgets are here and we're willing to, for all this gadgetness to be there endlessly, just the way it is. Willing for all these beings who are coming to this planet for the purpose of playing a role in negation. We're willing for them to be exactly the way they are, endlessly, not judging at all. No need, see, what you do is you step out of judgment, which is, again, that's what the Course in Miracles teaches, is to set down judgment and pick up forgiveness. But how do you actually do that more than conceptually? How do you do it with a feeling? As Muji says, you got to feel it, your salvation. You can't just conceptualize it. So how do you feel your salvation? Again, by extending endlessness to whatever arises, whatever you're aware of, whatever your attention is alighting upon. Be willing for that to be there endlessly. That you do feel. There is a kind of feeling that will, subtle feeling at first. At least that's what I'm feeling now. I'm just practicing it here for you publicly for the first time. There's a subtle feeling there. There's something there. When you do that, you actually become aware that what your practice has effect, a positive effect that is profound. You feel that there's something profound you just did. And quite frankly, the other ways I've tried, I've never felt anything. Really have not. because it was not actually doing the extension of endlessness. Not what wasn't a, an allowance. Here we're saying, I allow, I'm willing. You see, I'm willing for this to be here endlessly. No conditions, no judgment. Course in Miracles said, okay, set down your judgment, pick up forgiveness. That's the key to salvation, literally. That's the lineage that I teach from. And those who are continuing their self-inquiry, they can continue that, or if they like, they can listen to this and they might say, ha, this really is the key. You can get it through self-inquiry, I believe. I'm not certain. I don't know how hindsight is going to treat all those who took the path of self-inquiry. I don't really know. But I feel very strongly that loving it the way it is, by willing for everything to be just as it is, endlessly, is truly the way to salvation. It will truly work for you. And instead of watching the Super Bowl, you are listening to this, and you may be watching this actually later as a video, because I don't know if there's anybody watching this particularly, because I haven't told anybody about it. That's okay, because it's an experiment to see if it's possible. See, stop broadcasting, stop recording. Okay, it's going along now. Very good, very great. Starting to cool off out here. That's okay. I hope this is... I know this is being helpful for you if you're listening to it. It's not easy. Satsang is not easy. I found in Muji's Satsang, which I was doing over Ustream here in the Bay Area of California. It was difficult at times. It's a little bit of irritation would come up at time to time. My mind would wander a little bit from time to time. I'd get bored. You know, I'd say, oh, he told that story before, you know, or oh, these antics I've seen before. But then I say, no, he's right on track. He's right on track. He's keeping us on track. And, you know, and so the overall experience was very, very, very positive. I'm really grateful that I was able to participate in that. It was a profound experience, really, truly. I have to thank Muji for that, and the Sangha who enabled this, made it available to the world. It's just tremendous. Right here, there's no Sangha, just me, which gives me a little more flexibility, actually, because I'm not trying to please anyone, you see. There's no pressure. There's no audience here. There's no pressure for me to play the audience. There's no pressure for me to... I don't need to put the pressure on people in the audience. I don't need to meet any expectations of any audience. That's a positive thing. I don't have all these members of the Sangha, you know, coming here and doing this for me, doing that for me. Okay, go here and meet this person. Okay, take, you know, an organization grows, doesn't it? It has a life of its own. Here, right now, there's no organization. It's just me. Nobody's helping me really at all. I'm just, nobody even knows I'm doing this. Tell you the truth. Well, one person does, but not exactly what I'm saying. So, it's a great opportunity here to speak the truth, to say things that you might not ordinarily say in an audience, because you might think, like, oh, I wonder if they're going to like that or dislike that, you know. There's a certain amount of that. But here, it's just stream of consciousness, no notes, no agenda, really, just whatever I feel is important to say, that's what I'm saying. And we're hitting some high notes here. And again, what I just said is that the satsang can be difficult from your end. It can be. But don't give up on it. I didn't give up on Muji satsang. I really almost did. And I said, no, I'm going to see it through to the end. I want to see how it ends here. It's very interesting. The final satsang was very interesting. Because he really gave an altar call. Really put the pressure on. And I don't know exactly how that worked for people. A lot of people came up to the stage. A lot of weeping, a lot of emotion. His satsangs, that people tend to be very emotional, which is okay. And certainly the last day, a lot of intense, profound emotion. People just saying they've had a breakthrough, they've broken through, and they've realized their true being, beingness, a true extension, endless extension of beingness. And they're right there, and they're just, you know, just beside themselves. You know, it was really amazing, wonderful to see all that. I've never seen anything like it in my life, honestly. It was really an incredible thing. Now, is it a lasting breakthrough, et cetera, et cetera? Well, hindsight, we don't know. And Muji, you know, was pretty skeptical of it all. He said, well, we have a little more work to do. So, yeah, he wasn't quite, you know, he would always, he always asked questions about it, questions it, you know, which is, you know, can be pretty rough, you know, if you're in a state, if you really have had the breakthrough and you're in that, you know, being questioned at that point, like, well, who's the one who's having the experience, you know, that can throw you into sort of a state of confusion. I don't know. He knows his business. I don't know. But it could be tough. I can see that, you know, really. Here, I'm not putting that kind of pressure on you. I'm not saying, do you really have it? I mean, who is the one that is having it? Who is the one extending endlessness, you know? Doesn't matter. Because the way around that is to say, I'm willing, whatever is extending endlessness, I'm willing for that to endlessly extend that endlessness. You see that? You can always do that regression. So those kind of questions about, like, well, you know, who's having this experience or who is witnessing this, that's not important. It's really not. If you want to ask that, you can. But you can merely then feel, okay, whatever it is that is saying this, if it's my mind, that's fine. You say, well, I'm willing for my mind to conceptualize this this endlessness endlessly. Not a problem. It's a beautiful path I'm seeing opening up here for all of us. Not a moment too soon, really. I like it. You see how that works? Because there is some sort of what I was noticing. I wouldn't say that the questions were not legitimate. Certainly, he's continuing to put the pressure on. He's seeing a breakthrough, but then he wants it to deepen, and he wants people to stay with it. Here in this situation, it's a little different. It's quite a bit different in that you don't need a breakthrough. All you need to do is extend endlessness to whatever it is that it's arising, moment by moment. And if you fail to do that, extend endlessness to your failure to do that. You see? So there's almost, there's like a seamlessness to it already. From the very beginning, there is inherently a seamlessness to this practice, because there's nothing that can arise that you cannot extend your willingness for that to be there endlessly. I mean, other than your judgment. But it's really very simple if you want to be free from learning trying to learn the lessons of death, which is complete frustration and futility. All you have to do is be willing to then extend endlessness to whatever arises. Get out of your judgmental mind, judgmentalness, to forgiveness. Simply the attitude of forgiveness, but it's different than what you think. Forgiveness says, well, that person did something terrible to me, but I decide I'm not going to have revenge on them. That's not what Jesus is talking about in forgiveness. Forgiveness means you don't have to like what happened. You can say, you know, I really hated what that person did to me. But I'm willing to have that hate what they did. I'm willing for that to be with me endlessly. And I'm willing for what they did to be with me endlessly. And if you don't like what they did, I'm willing for that not to be with. I'm willing for what happened not to happen. I'm willing for that to be with me endlessly as well. In other words, if you want to, if you're angry at what happened, I'm willing for that anger to be with me endlessly. So it's inherently, you're always in the position of endlessness, which is your true identity. And right, like I said, it's seamless because you can apply that to anything. Let's say someone in satsang who has this breakthrough and they're being questioned and they say, well, I feel like, you know, I'm really here. And say, well, who's here? Who's here? You know, well, you say, well, I'm willing to be uncertain about that. That uncertainty, I'm willing for that to be with me endlessly, to be present with me endlessly, that uncertainty. Or if I'm mistaken, I'm willing for that mistakenness to be with me endlessly. or if I'm merely being arrogant and stating, well, I don't need any help. I'm willing for that arrogance to be with me endlessly. I'm willing. So your willingness for endlessness to be present, that can be seamless. There's nothing that can touch it, nothing that can trump it. Some teachers may play the one upsmanship game, which is to basically always ask, well, who is it that's having the experience, right? You might have this feeling of complete endlessness and then be asked, well, who is having this feeling of endlessness? And then you say, well, no one is. Well, who is aware of this? No one. They say, well, no one is aware of it. They say, ah, you know, you don't have it yet. it's easy to get into a position of one-upmanship. Not saying that any teachers do that in specifically, but it's very, very possible, very easy to do in non-dual teaching, very easy. But you can just completely bypass that by saying it's okay if I don't get it. It's okay if I do get it. It's okay if I don't get it. I'm willing to have this getting itness with me endlessly. I'm willing to have this non-getting itness getting itness with me endlessly. I'm willing to for the teacher to know more than me endlessly. I'm willing for me to know less endlessly. I'm willing for my stupidity to be with me endlessly. You see. So where are you in all these statements? You are endlessness. So the question of who is experiencing this? Endlessness is experiencing it. It's being experienced in, it's not who's experiencing it, it's being experienced within endlessness. And endlessness is your kingdom. You are within your kingdom. When you extend endlessness, you are within your kingdom right then and there. And to say, well, who is in the kingdom doesn't matter, because the kingdom is there, it's being felt. The kingdom is within the kingdom, because it's endless. Endlessness is within endlessness. Endless beingness is the identity, is identity. And everything can arise within that. You can either arise or not arise. Either way, it's the same. It's all arising within endlessness. So it's a very benevolent teaching. I feel it's a very, very loving teaching. It's not a teaching of any sort of gamesmanship or one-upmanship. It's not there. No potential for that. We don't need to ask, you know, who is experiencing it. It doesn't matter. You can say, I'm willing to have that question unanswered endlessly. I'm willing to not know who's experiencing it endlessly. I'm willing for everybody else to know and me not to know endlessly. Doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. All these negative positions, it's like water off a duck's back. What time is it? Past 5 o'clock. Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Wow. It's probably halftime, isn't it? Probably halftime. And I'm starting to get chilly. It's getting chilly out here. I might have to go get a coat at some point. Maybe I can keep on going a little bit here. It's still recording. Very good. Very great. Now, you will see commercials here because I cannot afford to pay for the premiere. This is the free version, which means you're getting advertisements. Or maybe, I mean, I wonder if I could pay monthly. I'll look into that. I'm not sure if it'll take away advertisements on your end or not. Because in watching Muji Satsang, there were advertisements every 10 minutes. There was like a 30-second advertisement that completely, you can't hear the satsang at all. But so, because of that, I am repeating and repeating and repeating, kind of reinforcing what I'm saying. So when you miss that 30-second ad is on, you come back, you'll still get the gist of what's being said here. And on my end, this is going great. I'm very relaxed, very happy. Everything is working great. It's not a problem here, talking like this. Don't know what the score is. Don't know what's happening. That's okay. I'm willing to not know the score. I'm also willing to know the score endlessly. It doesn't matter, does it? Be willing, whatever arises, loneliness, willing to be alone endlessly. And when you take that attitude, you extend that, what happens? You feel endlessness and you're not alone, are you? Because endlessness is its own companion. Endlessness is within endlessness. It's not alone. You can even say you're willing to be without endlessness endlessly, right? It's still there, isn't it? People in this world will say they're willing to die endlessly. Okay, I'm willing for you to be for you to be dying endlessly. Yeah, I extend an endlessness to that endless dyingness. No trouble. Someone says they want to be separate forever. Okay, I'm willing for you to for that willingness to be separate forever. I'm willing for that to be within endlessness, endlessly there, present for me. Yeah. No trouble. No trouble at all. You can see how this would lead to undisturbed peace, can't you? Is that simply nothing that comes up shifts you out of that feeling of endlessness? Because you're willing for everything that arises to be there endlessly. So that feeling of endlessness continues on seamlessly, doesn't it? That is the great secret. That is the great key. I told you I would present this to you in my previous video called Leave the Ego Satsang of Death. I promised I would give you this, but I had to just sort of, I wanted to finish up with Muji Satsang first. That was an experience I wanted in this life. I really wanted to see how a really top-notch satsang is conducted. And Muji's conducts his satsang is top-notch. Really, it is. You're talking about, he's a tremendous salesman and charismatic for the non-dual truth path of self-inquiry, of recognizing our beingness. Tremendously effective. Everyone handles their business there extremely well. Very well organized. Carried out to a T, everything. So that was really an amazing experience. It was more interesting than going to any symphony or ballet or opera or sporting event or whatever. Way more interesting. Way more compelling. Like I said, it was must-see internet. Whatever you get out of it, it was quite an experience. So with that over now, I feel, you know, that ended yesterday, and now I feel okay. Boom. Here we go with this satsang, internet satsang. Just like that. Perfect timing. And the introduction of this new way, it's really a reintroduction of the old way, of the way that actually is the most profound way, the most effective way. To tell you, to lay it out for you, as we have gone forward with science and technology over the last, 400 years or so, people have gradually been moving away from this most effective way because they want to get on the fence a little bit, because they want to see what all this science and technology, what this development is going to give them, and will it help them in learning how to die. And so we have really, as a world, moved away from the most effective spiritual practice. And it's been my life of work here to reintroduce this, to finally be able to pull it back into context, because what happened is we lost the context. It was still available. I mean, you can go to church any day. And what time is it? 5. I'll probably be going to church with my wife a little later on here, in about half an hour. And you go to church and what do you hear there? Well, what you hear is, you know, love your enemy, forgiveness, right? But the context has been watered down. So you don't quite set it. You don't realize the profundity of it, the importance of it, the immense capacity that it has to save you. It's kind of like everybody's kind of half asleep, you know, and they're just sort of like zombies, kind of. Because their attention is split, they're trying to serve two masters. They're trying to say, well, all this computational science, technology, power may be helping me become prime creator. So I'm sort of putting this other thing on the back burner for now. So what I'm doing is I'm bringing it, putting it on the front burner for you. That's all I'm doing. I'm saying, hey, it's time to employ this most powerful tool there is. Loving it the way that it is. Be willing to extend endlessness to whatever arises. That is the most powerful tool. I know Ramana said that self-inquiry, the time for self-inquiry was the most effective when he was teaching. But I will say now that this tool here, I will say that is the most effective tool. We can say equally effective, most effective. Of course, it's only effective if you use it. But from my standpoint, it resolves some of the troubles of non-dual teaching situation. From what I saw, minor stuff. There's some stuff there that maybe might be causing people a little bit of trouble. They're really struggling with it to a certain extent. I see that. I saw some of that, you know, it was minor stuff, but it's still there. And I believe this way, it's like the superhighway, bypasses all of that. It's no trouble whatsoever. The only difficulty is actually being willing to get into that mode of forgiveness, extending, you know, there are people who, you know, hate what's going on, which is fine. Extend your love for the hate. That's okay. But they want a resolution. In other words, they want to defeat their enemy instead of love their enemy. And this is what I see in monitoring the world situation as I do through the internet and being aware of what's going on, really, in many ways. The attitudes are one, basically, it's the attitude of we need to defeat our enemy before we can be happy. And I'm telling you right now, you can be happy right now. And you could even say you're willing to have the attitude of wanting to defeat your enemies. I'm willing to have that present endlessly, you see? You don't need to change it. So it's not a matter of having to change any attitude you have. It's simply willing to allow that attitude to be present endlessly, you see? So it completely bypasses basically everything, all teaching in this world. You don't have to change anything. You don't have to change your attitude. You don't have to change your personality. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to stop being the way you are. You don't have to stop being a social activist. You don't have to stop being an occupyist. You don't have to stop being a one percenter. You don't have to stop being a liberal or conservative or progressive or this and that. You don't have to stop being an environmentalist or an exploiter of the environment, a capitalist, a socialist, a this religion, that religion, pro this, con this. You don't have to stop any of that. And you don't have to stop anybody else from being the way they are. Or you don't have to stop trying to stop them. You merely have to be willing for whatever you're doing to say, I'm willing for that action, attitude to be present endlessly. That's all you have to do. And right then, like Jesus said, you're in paradise. The thief, one of the thieves, you know, on the cross, on his side said, you know what, I really get who you are and what you're saying, and I agree. You know, I really see that you're willing for this crucifixion to be take place endlessly. You're not opposing it. And Jesus said, right then, you'll be with me in paradise, just like that, the first one, see, so to speak. You'll be with me in paradise right now, right then and there, because that thief got it. And the thief said, I'm willing for whatever's taking place to my body here to be taking place endlessly. No judgment. And even said, I hate what's taking place. I'm willing to hate what's taking place. I'm willing for that to be present endlessly. So somehow that thief got it right away, transcended the entire situation, hanging on the cross, dying. You can do the very same thing, because essentially we're all on a cross. To tell you the honest facts of the situation, the actual facts. Here comes the cat. We're all on a cross of dying, aren't we? We're all being crucified. That was Jesus just depicted this. We're all being crucified, continually crucified. We're on. As soon as we're born, we're born nailed to a cross. That is a fact. And our entire lives are just a slow, painful crucifixion. Hi, cat. You're getting hungry, huh? You're getting hungry. What are you going to do? You're going to mess everything up here? Yes, you are. You're going to hit my mouse pad? You did. That was the cat. He hit something. And it's okay. You didn't hurt anything because I anticipated what you were going to do, right? Okay. Okay. Hey, see? See, even cats, sometimes they hit stuff, right? They won't admit it, will they? They never admit that they hit something, because they're very careful. They're looking around, they're going to jump, and they jump, and they hit something. Like, what the heck was that? That wasn't me, was it? But I thought you might do that, and you did it. Yeah. And so you can say, yeah, I'm willing for the cat to hit that endlessly, or not hit that endlessly. I'm willing for whatever happens to happen endlessly, or for whatever doesn't happen to also be endlessly present. Because a lot of this world is what's not happening, right? You may be praying for stuff to happen, it doesn't happen. So you should say, well, I'm willing for my prayers not to be answered. I'm willing for that situation to be present endlessly. I'm willing for all the stuff that hasn't happened for me to continue to not happen for me endlessly. I'm not sure if this cat is willing to be hungry endlessly, though. See, that's the thing. Well, you can also say that you're willing for your desire to eat, for that to be present endlessly as well. So there's no conflict with anything. There's not even any conflict with conflict. Want to say hello to the camera? No? Trying to. Hello, cat. Okay, very good. Camera shy. Not interested. Why should he be? So, the most suspicious recording here today. Very, very keen on being able to reintroduce this, and set it into the right context, this most profound, powerful spiritual path that can have effects very, very quickly. And we'll see how quickly it goes, but I expect that this will have a really profound, profound effect. And then I'll be able to be even more certain about it, which will help you. Because I know it's not easy for you. You're going to get bored. You're going to say, I'm tired of listening to this guy talk about this. Then just say, okay, I'm willing to be tired. I'm willing for that feeling of tiredness about listening to this guy. I'm willing for that to be there endlessly. Boom, there you are again. Suddenly you're right back to endlessness. And maybe you even forget about applying this. And then just say, oh, I'm willing to forget about applying this endlessness technique. I'm willing to be forgetful of that endlessly. You see, and boom, you're right back. Very easy to stay with it, you see. Yeah, it's food time for the cat. Of course, he doesn't eat much, but it's the symbology of it for him. He's getting fed. Kind of smells it a little bit, and tastes it a little bit. That's enough. It's not that great. Same as yesterday. But at least someone put something out, an offering for him, and he appreciates that very much so. But in this case, we need to practice the situation. And if everything goes according to Hoyle, if it goes the right way, we will be able to practice this, and I will be available to encourage you to practice it. And there's no reason why we cannot do these live satsangs. I've set everything up. I'm doing it right now. It's a piece of cake. It's being recorded onto Ustream, that you can download it, or you can watch it on Ustream if you want. anytime, and we can literally do this practice. And maybe at some point I'll be able to expand this. There's a chat feature I see here. Might be able to take some questions, but what is there really to question? Because really the answer to any question is not to answer the question, but just to say, be willing to not have the answer to the question, be present endlessly. I'm willing to not have that question answered endlessly. It doesn't matter, because the only important thing is endlessness. So it really makes it a lot simpler for you, doesn't it? Because you really don't have to ask any questions. You don't need to have any questions answered. Well, what do you think about this teacher? Well, you're willing to have any attitude whatsoever towards the teacher expressed endlessly, present with you endlessly. Doesn't really matter, does it? It can either matter or not matter, but as long as you extend it, whatever arises, extend the context of endlessness to it. You haven't moved the slightest bit. You're still perfectly present. You're still with that endlessness. And that's the key. That is the key. Hello, cat. How are you? He's going to start probably getting agitated in a little while. That's his M.O., you know. Very, very peaceful. Very patient. Very serene. But when he starts getting a little more hungry, he starts agitation, starts bothering me, and it begins to gradually escalate it. And if you don't respond to it, he ups it a little bit more. Finally, he starts, you know, snagging your clothing. That generally works. That's kind of his ace in the hole, is get the claws in the clothing and start snagging it, because he knows that'll get a shout and people will say, okay, just don't snag my clothes. He knows all the various tricks on how to cause us to finally pay attention to him. A little bite here, you know, a little nip works, but the snagging of the clothing is really, that's very effective. But we don't need to put that kind of pressure on one another. We need to simply accept this old, classical, profoundly effective way. That has been reset in the right context here. Clarity Ross is doing that right now. And begin to practice that. And it really, if we do it, if we practice it, and we will, it will be absolutely profound. It will enable you to literally transcend the entire situation here. It will literally enable you to relocate, should you want to do that. Because after all, it is kind of boring. The lessons of trying to die are boring, aren't they? Because you know it's useless. It's a waste of your time. You don't even need to focus on it at all. You don't need to focus on all the bombs falling. You know, you don't need to be watching the television and the networks are bringing you the war live. You see all the explosions and you know everybody's dying and getting blown to pieces. And you don't need to be aware of that, because it's futile. It's meaningless. It doesn't teach anything. Those who are watching the television, they're obviously trying to learn how to die. Their spirit is interested in all this dyingness that's going on, this destructivity. Why are they interested? Because they want to learn how to die. Spirit can't die, but it's fascinated by dying. It wants to learn how to do it. And like I said, bodies are never alive in the first place. So what's dying is it was never alive. So it's not really dying at all. There's really no death taking place at all. That's a fact. Nothing has ever died, because nothing's ever been alive in the first place here. Spirit is immortal, so it's never died. And everything that we're imagining here as props, teaching lessons here to die, was never alive in the first place, so it hasn't died either. All the animals, all the vegetation, nothing here is actually alive in the first place, so it never died either. It's just a prop that's being used in a certain way. So you're not really learning anything here. You can't learn to die, and there's no dying actually taking place here. So, complete waste of time. Very boring. Non-interesting. Not interesting at all. So you do have a right to relocate to the death-free realms. You absolutely have that right. And when you're able to forgive this world and extend endlessness to everything that takes place here easily, seamlessly, flawlessly, you know, there's no trouble at all to relocate to death-free realms. Because you're willing for everything that's taking place here, you're willing for that to continue on endlessly. You don't need to be here for it to continue on. You're also willing for it to stop endlessly. Either way, it's no difference. So you're free. You're free. You're free to go to the death-free realms, which are wonderful. You know, it really engages you because you feel the endlessness of everything, and it's so beautiful. It really reminds you of your true identity most profound way. And you forget all about dreams of negation. You really do. I'm probably going to get the call to go to church soon. So, this has been a pretty good recording, hasn't it? Oh, it's over. I think it's a couple hours already. I started at 3:30, and it's now almost 5:30, so it'll be about 2 hours. That's good enough. And besides, this cat wants to be fed very soon. Right, kitty? Yeah. He's usually very talkative, but not right now. Maybe he realizes I'm talking, doesn't want to interrupt me, but I don't think so. No, his manners aren't quite that good. Just remember, nothing has ever died. Nothing has ever died. There's never been any death take place, not even one. Because everything that dies is just a construct. It's dust, it's fragments that have been glued together and held together only for them to then come apart again. Everything here is animated in some way, but this animation is not life. Life is eternal. The only life there is eternal life. Eternal life cannot die. It's endless extension of beingness. Endlessness can't come to an end. Life is literally endlessness. How can endlessness come to an end? It cannot. How can it die? It cannot. Very simple. So you see bodies seeming to die never were alive in the first place. So what's happening is simply meaningless. We're just deceiving ourselves, trying to deceive ourselves into believing that we're learning something, learning about death. We're not. We're wasting our time. The more you realize that, the less afraid you are to relocate to the death-free realms. Say, why not? There's nothing here to learn. So these teachings can be valuable either if you stay here or if you relocate, either way. If you stay here, you can still have absolutely seamless experience of your true being. Seamless. Endlessness. You must practice this, though. You must practice it. And we will do that. It's easy. As we see here, it's easy. Now, I know those in non-dual teachings may not be used to this. You know, those, of course, in miracles, probably a little easier. They get it. I think you get it. If you've been with the Course in Miracles, I think it's pretty easy for you to get this. Non-dual will still be stable. Who's the one who is doing this extending? And again, we say, we're perfectly willing for that question to be unanswered endlessly. Doesn't matter. It can be the I. It can be the not I. Everything can arise in endlessness. The I can arise, the not I can arise, everything can arise, nothing can arise. It's all within the same endlessness. And so you allow all of that, your willingness to allow everything to be present endlessly frees you up from everything, doesn't it? Frees you from every dynamic. You're not pulled in by any dynamic whatsoever. And who's this you again? Doesn't matter, does it? You can be anything. It's just endlessness is not being pulled away from endlessness. It realizes that endlessness is within endlessness, endlessly. It's endlessly one with itself. You're gonna get up, cat? Okay. Now he's gonna start his amplification, intensification. Pretty soon, huh? Okay, well, this has been a wonderful, wonderful kickoff, which is an apropos analogy, an apropos metaphor for what we've been doing. A lot of dogs walking up and down the street today. A lot of people take their dogs for a walk. The cat just looks at them and says, not impressed. Says they got a leash on them. I don't. I'm free. See, a cat is really free. The cat can go any place they want to anytime. This cat will just take off whenever. Doesn't have to say where it's going. If we call it to come back, he doesn't have to pay any attention. It's a very, very nice life for cats. It's almost like cat heaven, really. Can eat whenever they want to. Pretty good life, huh, cat? Yeah. But we, our life, not so good. Because we are really frustrated about not being able to learn how to die. Very upset about that. We think there's something wrong with us, you know. There's really something wrong with us. We can't seem to learn this, and it doesn't stick with us. And I wonder if those in non-dual satsang, if they have a breakthrough, and then they try to put it back in the context of learning how to die. They say, wow, I really must have empowered my capability to learn how to die. So I think that's why they then fall back down into what they, quote-unquote, they call the mind, or identification with the mind, is because they feel this empowerment taking place, but their context hasn't been clarified sufficiently. And they find themselves then thinking that they can now really empower, that they're able to be much better at learning how to die. And unfortunately, I believe that's what's happened to a lot, because you see certain breakthroughs and then you see them kind of sink back down. That's what's been happening. But if you put it in the right context, which is what we're doing here from the very beginning, is the context is important. It's not the realization, it's the context of putting everything, including your realization, into a willingness for that to be present endlessly. Then you're not going to sink down. That's the neighbor. Okay. I don't know if the neighbor is willing to put this satsang, be willing for that to be present endlessly. But I'm willing for them to not be willing for it to be present endlessly. I'm willing for that to be present endlessly. That's okay. But I try to keep it quiet here. Don't need to be shouting this. You can hear fine. The audio's fine for you. Well, maybe that's a wrap. Thank you so much for joining in and being part of this presentation of revitalizing this most ancient and most profound technique for true liberation, true salvation, putting it in the right context and actually then practicing it here for the first time. And we're doing it online live like this. It's tremendous. So, this is Clarity Ross and saying we'll see you next time. I'm going to now go into the blank shot and then stop the broadcast. We'll see you next time. Very great. That's it.